So when we last left our story in Luke, before we celebrated Easter, we studied one of the great parables of Jesus, the parable of the soils. And the concept of hearing God's word turned out to be central to that parable. When he told the parable to the crowds, he said, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. Right? In other words, let him understand. And then when he explained it to the disciples, he said, but the seed is the word of God. The seed in all those soils is the word of God, and each different kind of soil is a different kind of hearing. So we liken that to the heart, but in reality, each soil can be compared to a different kind of earwax. All right, we're not going to pursue that too hard because it's kind of gross. Right, but Jesus does, in that parable, make hearing the key. And he's not done with that subject. In today's text, he says, you, be careful how you hear. And that careful, obedient hearing has tremendous benefits. So in our lives, hearing is important. I know that's true because I have a modest but significant hearing loss. So here's the story. There once was a man who thought that his wife had grown hard of hearing. So he decided to test her. So one day he walked into the living room, and she was seated with her back to him, and he said, can you hear me? She didn't respond. He moved a little closer. Can you hear me? Again, no response. Finally, he got right behind her. Can you hear me? She turned around. For the third time, yes! But hearing is much more than just hearing words. Kent Crockett tells a story that he says actually happened to him. He says he walked into a fast food restaurant counter and the cashier asked, is this for here or to go? To go, I replied. I'll take a cheeseburger and fries. Okay, she said, cheeseburger and fries. For here or to go? To go, I answered, figuring she didn't hear me the first time. Anything else? Yes, I'll take a small Diet Coke and an apple pie. That'll be a cheeseburger, fries, small Diet Coke, and an apple pie. Is that for here or to go? I wondered if I was being videotaped for a hidden camera show. To go, please, I said, for the third time, chuckling under my breath. When they brought my order to the counter, it was on a tray. So you can hear words without listening. Again, the story is told of Franklin Roosevelt, who complained that nobody really paid attention to what he said. They always had their own agenda. So one day, during a reception, he decided to try an experiment. To each person who went by, he took his hand, shook it, and murmured, I murdered my grandmother this morning. The guest responded with phrases like, oh, marvelous, keep up the good work. We're so proud of you. God bless you, sir. It was not until the end of the line, while greeting the ambassador from Bolivia, that his words were actually heard. The ambassador leaned over and whispered, I'm sure she had it coming. So today we'll see that careful, obedient hearing of Jesus' words has great benefits. We'll see that we need to be hearing the word for the purpose of integrity. We need to be hearing the word for the purpose of intimacy with God, and we need to be hearing for security in the storms of life. So let's begin with Luke 8, 16 to 18, hearing well for the sake of integrity. No one, Jesus says, after lighting a lamp, covers it with a jar or puts it under a bed, but puts it under a stand so that those who enter may see the light. For nothing is hidden that will not be made manifest, nor is anything secret that will not be known and come to light. Take care, then, how you hear. For to the one who has, more will be given, and from the one who has not, even what he thinks he has will be taken away. Integrity, various definitions. One is to be the same on the inside as you are on the outside. And the images in these verses picture integrity. First, Jesus says, no one lights a lamp and hides it in a jar or puts it under a bed. Remember, we're in context here. The lamp is like the seed in the parable of the soils. If you have a light inside you, if you have the word growing within you, then integrity demands that you do not hide the light or choke the growth. Rather, you let the light shine out from you. You let the kingdom seed grow within you and bear fruit in the world. Now, in Palestine, it may have been the custom to put out an oil lamp by putting it under a jar. But what is the use of lighting it if you're just going to extinguish it? What is the use of lighting a lamp if you're just going to put it under a bed, which sounds dangerous in and of itself? But under the bed, it illuminates nothing. Jesus says, no, put it on a stand so that those who come in can see the light. This is integrity, to let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. People who see us should see the light of Christ within us, not the lamp that's us. But Jesus says this light works on you in the other direction too, not just out from you, but verse 17, for nothing is hidden that will not be made manifest, nor is anything secret that will not be made known and come to the light. So in addition to shining out from us, the light inside also reveals us as we are. Under the light of Jesus' words, the hidden things within us will be disclosed. Or to back up again, the kind of soil you are, the kind of earwax you are, will ultimately be revealed by your fruit. Do you have hidden attitudes in your heart, hidden hypocrisies of your life? Or those things are plain to the Savior? And often he chooses to make them known, not only to you, for the sake of confession and repentance, but sometimes to others for the sake of accountability, or so that you might be chastened and taught by the consequences. All right, so let's say I came to you after church today, and I said, but I've learned what you've been hiding all this time. Would you think I was crazy? Or would your thoughts immediately go to a particular subject, a particular sin that has burdened you, so that you wondered how I found out about that thing? Well, if there's any of that in your heart right at the moment, right, that is an issue of integrity in your life that needs to be addressed. Now, I won't do that. I don't know your hidden sin, but Jesus does. He wants to flood it with his light in order to rescue you from it. Which leads us to verse 18, take care then how you hear. Again, he's referring back directly to the parable of the soils with this word hear. The parable referred to the various groups of people and the outcome for the seed, and all of that was cast in terms of how they heard the word of God, the message of Jesus. Depending on how you listen to the word, you can be the hardened soil, the dry soil on the rock, the thorny soil, or the good soil. And it all depends on being careful how you hear. Don't hear flippantly. Don't hear distractedly. Don't hear hypocritically. Instead, listen to the word of God and hear the words of Jesus humbly, openly, and sincerely. Let me say that again. I would have loved to have spent more time on this slide, but don't hear flippantly. Don't hear distractedly, don't hear hypocritically, but hear humbly, hear openly to what Jesus is saying. Hear with sincerity of heart. For to the one who has more, Jesus says, more will be given. And from the one who has not, even when he thinks he has, will be taken away. This is a typical saying of Jesus. And in the context, what he means is that if you think you are listening well and being obedient, but you really aren't, you will not produce fruit. You will do one of those other soil things, wither, die, be choked off by cares. But if you are truly obedient, listening and responding with integrity to the message, then you will have much fruit. So the first reason to take care how you hear, to be careful how you hear, well, that you hear well so that the light can work integrity in you. If you want to be a person of integrity whose light cleanses within and shines out, listen well and obey the desires of Jesus as expressed in his word. But hearing is not all responsibility, hard work, and self-examination. And I'm so excited about these three verses. We also want to take care of how we hear, because that's the way to deep intimacy with Jesus. Luke 8:19 to 21. Then his mother and his brothers came to him, but they could not reach him because of the crowd. And he was told, "Your mother and your brothers are standing outside desiring to see you." But he answered them, "My mother and my brothers are those who hear the word of God and do it." Jesus is pretty blunt. Those who hear and obey are those who are really close to him, as close as his mother, as close as his brothers. Now, just in a little side trip, this is one of several references to Jesus' family. There's a detailed description in Matthew 13. Coming to his hometown, he taught them in their synagogue so that they were astonished, and they said, "Where did this man get this wisdom and these mighty works? Is not this the carpenter's son? Is not his mother called Mary? And are not his brothers James and Joseph and Simon and Judas? Are not all his sisters with us?" Now, the Catholic Church would have us believe that Mary remained a virgin and that these brothers and sisters were really cousins or children of Joseph by an earlier marriage. But there is no biblical evidence that would allow us to interpret these texts in such a strained way. And these are, I believe, Jesus' brothers, Mary's children, Jesus' sisters. They've come to visit Jesus, but they can't get close because of the crowd. Again, little side note, this is about the 10th time that Matthew has referred to the crowds in this middle section. I mean, this middle part of Jesus' ministry is the huge peak of his popularity. Wherever he goes, these huge crowds follow to listen. And so apparently at this point he's inside a house, or maybe even inside the synagogue, and his mother and brothers can't even get inside because of the crowd. But somebody out there recognizes them, or they speak to someone out there, and the word gets to Jesus that your mother and your brothers are standing outside desiring to see you. You know, we would expect Jesus to respond warmly to this. We actually do know that he had a good relationship with his mother, even at the crucifixion. And we know that one of his brothers, James, became a key leader in the church. On the other hand, we also know there was a time when his family did not believe he was the Christ. John tells us that, and Mark records an incident in which they accused him of being, a little mentally unstable. So the relationship was not always positive. We don't know exactly what their motives were for visiting him this time. But what is clear is this, that Jesus chooses to use this moment as an opportunity to teach something very important to us as followers. He replies, "My mother and my brothers are those who hear the word of God and do it." Now, see what's happening here. Jesus is describing the closest of relationships, these intimate family relationships. You'll be as close to me as a mother. You'll be as close to me as a brother. Why? How? If you hear my word and do it. So an essential part of intimacy or relationship with Jesus is to listen to his words, to hear them with integrity, with the kind of hearing that responds to what he says. So it's to put your house on the rock, the firm foundation. To do that, you have to put his commands into practice. But don't miss the promise. This lovely promise of closeness to Jesus. So if you were today to rate the closeness of your relationship with Jesus on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being he's a complete stranger to me, 10 being the closest possible bond, the closest possible relationship, so where would you fall on that scale? And does it even occur to you that obedience would make that number go up? I mean, it's easy to see obedience as something cold and formal, imposed and difficult, something like slavery, something that strains relationships and doesn't build them. But Jesus says that obedience draws us close, wraps us in his love, comforts his heart, that it's better than the best of family relationships. And the key is to hear his word as the word of a mother, a father, a brother, which draws us into action, which draws us into relationship, and in his case, it's out of friendship and out of commitment to him. That's the intimacy that I think we desire, that family intimacy with Jesus. And through the history of the church, there have been many, many people who have experienced exactly what Jesus is saying here, that the obedient child enjoys this special intimacy with the Savior. St. Augustine, 4th century there, describes this so wonderfully. I'm going to read you this whole quote. "I love you, Lord." Sorry, side note. How often do you actually say that? "I love you, Lord, not doubtingly, but with absolute certainty. Your word beat upon my heart until I fall in love with you. And what do I love when I love you? Not physical beauty, or the grandeur of our existence in time, or the radiance of light that pleases the eye, or the sweet melody of old familiar songs, or the fragrance of flowers, or the taste of manna or honey, or the arms we use to clasp each other. None of these do I love when I love my God. Yet there is a kind of light, and a kind of melody, and a kind of fragrance, and a kind of food, and a kind of embracing when I love my God." Brother Lawrence, 17th century. "The practice of the presence of God." Here's another picture of intimacy of the obedient. He says, I have no other will but God's will, which I seek to fulfill in all things, and to which I am so committed that I would not wish to pick up a piece of straw without his command. I do nothing else but abide in his holy presence, and I do this by a simple attentiveness and a habitual loving turning of my eyes on him. This I would call the actual presence of God, or to put it better, a wordless and secret conversation between the soul and God. The King, full of goodness and mercy, embraces me lovingly, makes me eat at his table, serves me with his own hands, gives me the keys to his treasures, and treats me just as if I were his favorite. That's the kind of intimacy we long for. Now, if you think that maybe that kind of intimacy passed away centuries ago, that intimacy through hearing and doing the Word of God is ancient, let me assure you that it's still true and much closer to home. I love reading the notes that volunteers leave in our guest book after serving with Crisis Response. Notes like, "This past week has been so amazing. I have seen God in special ways each day, and getting to be here serving gives me so much joy. I find myself having a growth in my walk with Christ this week." Or this one, "Praising God for his work in us that continues to grow us closer and more like Jesus." You find that kind of thing throughout the book. Or this one here, "Dearest Jesus, we saw you in each part of the week. In the work, in the prayer, in the sharing times, in our prayer walks, etc." So there is first this integrity. And that grows from taking care of how you hear the word. But there is second, this wonderful intimacy that comes with hearing his word and doing it. And finally, there's a security that comes, I believe, also from careful hearing of Jesus. Verses 22 to 25. "One day, he got into a boat with his disciples, and he said to them, 'Let us go across to the other side of the lake.' So they set out. And as they sailed, he fell asleep. And a windstorm came down on the lake, and they were filling with water and were in danger. They went and woke him, saying, 'Master, Master, we are perishing.' And he awoke and rebuked the wind and the raging waves, and they ceased, and there was a calm. He said to them, Where is your faith? And they were afraid, and they marveled, saying to one another, Who then is this that he commands even winds and water, and they obey him? Jesus calls his disciples to leave the crowd, to get in a boat, to cross the Sea of Galilee. You remember, of course, that the Sea of Galilee, or Tiberias, is really a lake. It's about 13 miles long, about 8 miles wide. So to put that in context, it's bigger than Clear Lake, but smaller than Galveston Bay. This lake is located 700 feet below sea level, and it's surrounded by mountains, and strong, unpredictable winds often come barreling down the mountains, making the small lake at times as dangerous as an ocean. It's unlikely that there was any sign of a storm at the moment when Jesus and the disciples got in his boat and headed across the lake. And so as they're going along, we see evidence of Jesus' humanity in the fact that he fell asleep in the boat. I expect by this point in his ministry, Jesus was humanly tired. Chapter after chapter, he's been pursued by these large crowds. And, you know, as we just read, not even his mother and brothers could get through these crowds. And so when Jesus says, let's get in a boat, go on the other side of the lake, it was partly to escape the crowds, to get some rest, to go away with his disciples. And he takes a nap in the boat. But the storm that comes up is so strong, so sudden, that the experienced fishermen manning the boat are convinced they're going to drown, that the boat is being swamped. It's being filled with water. Mark's account of this event tells us specifically that the disciples were terrified. So they wake Jesus in alarm. They cry out to him, Master, Master, we're drowning. Now, it's not at all clear to me what they actually expected when they woke Jesus. It may simply be that they were preparing to abandon ship and wanted to make sure that he was ready. Or maybe some of them thought he should be helping them. Why should he be asleep when the rest are straining every muscle to save the boat? On the other hand, some of them may have had an inkling that this Jesus who they'd been spending all this time with could do something supernatural to help them. But before we talk about what Jesus did, I want to look back at the episode for a second with kind of the 2020 hindsight and think about it together. So who were they actually with? They were with the Son of God, the Messiah of promise, the Lord of the universe, the Master of all things. Furthermore, they were at this point doing what he told them to do. They had heard and were doing. Let's go to the other side of the lake, he had said. They were doing his will. Implication? Well, they were in fact safe the whole time. They were listening to God the Son, and they were obeying him. It's really not likely that Jesus was going to drown at this point in his ministry. So it's really unlikely that they were going to drown in this event. Because when you're with Jesus, when you're doing his will, you're secure no matter what storm may continue to rage. Obedience to Jesus is the safest place you can be. So when the disciples wake Jesus up, it's really out of compassion for them that he rebukes the wind and the raging waters, and the storm subsides, and all is calm. And this applies to you and me. Why can we have security? Because, first, Jesus does have the power and the authority to calm any troubled sea. He can, to this day, to this moment, as we just heard, he can keep and guard and protect and provide for his own. It's this infinite power, which we call omnipotence, that provides half the reason why it's reasonable to be secure, English Bob, why it's reasonable to be secure in our faith day by day. The other half of the reason is because Jesus really cares for us. He cares about his disciples. He cares about us. Because of his love, he wants to do what's best for us, and because of his power, he is able to do whatever he wants. if the disciples had been taking care to hear Jesus, or really taking care to see Jesus, they would have been, in a very practical way, more secure at this moment. I mean, think about the history. Several of them had seen the miraculous catch of fish. Most of them had seen him heal the centurion's son with only a word at a distance. They had seen him raise a woman's child from the dead. They had seen him heal over and over the man with leprosy, casting out the demons. Furthermore, they had heard Jesus command faith, especially the faith of some of these people, the faith of the centurion, his great confidence in Jesus' power. But somehow, even in the face of all this evidence of Jesus' care and Jesus' power, they didn't have faith at that moment when the storm raged. He turns to them and asks, "Where is your faith? Why do you not yet have confidence in me?" And it's possible for them at this point in the gospel that they weren't yet really sure who he was. I mean, we haven't gotten to chapter 9. Jesus hadn't yet asked him that central question, "Who do you say that I am?" Peter hasn't responded that he's the Christ, the promised Messiah. So they're still a little bit in the place of, "Who is this?" Which is what they say here. But what's our excuse? We not only have all those miracles and all that testimony to cling to, but we have the resurrection. We have his victory as a foundation for our faith and confidence. We can have that confidence as we try to be obedient, seeking to carefully hear his word. We can have that faith, that real confidence in the security of our position, no matter what storms he might allow in our lives. As one of the storm songs we've sung over the years says, sometimes he calms the storm, other times he calms his child. And I've seen that. That's security, that's intimacy. We can have confidence that by his love, he will never leave us or forsake us. We can have confidence that when we pray according to his will, he will delight to answer us, to rescue us, even to calm a raging sea. And it's careful hearing of his word that gets us to that security. We are held in his arms. We are protected. We know him intimately, as he just said, the same Jesus who commands even the winds and the water, and they obey him. It's funny here that the very forces of nature do what he said in the previous two sections. They heard him and did what he said. But sometimes we do see miracles, even in our own situations. I've seen it often over nearly 50 years as a believer. And the testimony we just heard from Luke, I mean, these kind of slow motion waiting period, miraculous answers to prayer and the sale of his house and the provision of the job, right? This is evidence that's not in our timing, but yet in reality, God is at work and we can have confidence in him. That's how Jesus speaks into a storm. And yet the question Jesus asks, "Where is your faith?" draws us back to the question of careful hearing. Because I think our faith grows in those moments as we see the things that he does. But often in the midst of chaos, we can miss the patterns of his provision. So what does he expect us to do? I firmly believe it's to go back to the basics, back to the word, to ask ourselves, okay, well, what does God teach as true? What's the truth in this situation? What's true about his character? What do I know about his character? What's true about his provision? What do I know about what he's done in the past? What's true about his promises? What has he told me will be true? What is true about God's loving kindness, his chesed? It's when we become convicted of these things, hear these things, to put them into our lives, that's when we have security in the storms of life and the storms of our faith. So what have we seen? First benefit of careful hearing is integrity. When a hearer's word, to obey it, the light shines within and without, letting his presence shine in us and through us. Second benefit of hearing his word and doing it is that intimacy. those who learn to hear the Savior and do his will discover this very profound relationship of love with the Savior. Closer even, he says, than the human relationship of mother or brother. And the third benefit of really listening is security. If you're going where the Savior is going, and the Savior is going there with you, nothing can really harm you. You can have great confidence, the same confidence that the disciples lacked, and you can have that confidence even while waiting well, even while your storm continues to rage. If my Savior is with me in this boat, then I don't have to be afraid. So I want to close with an illustration from my old field of mechanical engineering. Ben, I'm glad you made it right from the turnaround to hear this. I said to Betsy, I wanted you to hear this one. But it's from my field of mechanical engineering. And the illustration rises out of a mechanical engineer's definition of integrity. So in my field, dealing with pressure vessels, integrity meant no leaks. Right? I worked with pressure vessels, these big metal tanks, towers, all this stuff in chemical plants. And when you put a pressurized gas or a highly pressurized liquid inside a vessel, the last thing you want is a leak. So you check and recheck the integrity of the vessel. Now there's one special kind of pressure vessel that's called a layered vessel. It's made with a thin layer of some special material. It might be corrosion resistant or good at high temperature. Titanium's a popular one, but it's expensive. So behind that thin layer, they put a thick layer of regular steel to hold that insides in place. Okay, so think of yourself. Think of your life in yourself as the thin inner layer. When the pressure is applied, when the stress builds up, if that thin inner layer tries to stand alone, it doesn't. It balloons and then it bursts. It loses its integrity and everything spills out. That's us without Jesus. But when the steel is added around the thin layer, when Jesus surrounds you, then you can have integrity. You don't leak because the steel absorbs the force. The steel absorbs the stress. Instead, what you get is intimacy. As the pressure mounts on that thin layer, it's pressed more and more into the supporting steel that surrounds it. And you get security. The thin layer can't handle the pressure alone, but the steel can handle it easily. No matter how high the pressure gets, the thin layer isn't bothered at all. So you and I are very thin layers. But if we listen carefully to what Jesus says, we'll find that even when the pressures build up and the stresses increase and the storms rage, we have Jesus around us to maintain our integrity, to support us fully through an intimate relationship, and to give us the security that we need. Careful, obedient, hearing of Jesus' word gives us these.